Let's take a look at the assumptions of the t-test on the population mean mu. For the one sample t-test to be valid, we require two things. First, we need a simple random sample from the population. If our sampling design is poor, then our conclusions may be very misleading. Secondly, we need a normally distributed population, although this assumption is not that important if our sample size is large. If the normality assumption is violated, what are the consequences? The reported p-value will be different from the true p-value. The reported p-value will not properly reflect the reality of the situation. And the reported significance level will be different from the true significance level. But these problems will become less of an issue as the sample size increases, largely due to the central limit theorem. Let's look at a very rough guideline that I'm going to illustrate later on in this video using simulation. If the sample size is greater than 40, the t procedures work well in most situations. This is not a hard and fast rule, as the t procedures may still perform poorly if the sample size is greater than 40, but in most practical situations, it's reasonable to use the t procedures if we have samples of this size. If the sample size is between 15 and 40, the t procedures may perform reasonably well, but they do not work well if there is strong skewness or outliers. Skewness and outliers can cause the t-procedures to perform very poorly. If the sample size is smaller still, less than 15 say, one should be wary of using the t-procedures. It may still be reasonable to use the t-procedures if we are very confident that the population is approximately normally distributed. But if that assumption is not the case, the t-procedures can perform very poorly for sample sizes that are this small. Let's investigate the effect of a violation of the normality assumption on the t-test using simulation. Here I've plotted out four distributions. One of them is the normal distribution, so if we're sampling from that distribution, the normality assumption is perfectly justified. The other three are definitely not normal, and so if we were sampling from these distributions, the normality assumption of the t-test would be violated. What effect does this have on the t-test? Let's use simulation to investigate that. We're going to draw 100,000 samples from each of those four distributions for each of several different sample sizes. Then we're going to carry out a hypothesis test of the null hypothesis that mu is equal to mu naught at an alpha level of 0.05 in that scenario. And the null hypothesis is going to be true in each case. Then we're going to look to see what percentage of tests reject the null hypothesis. And if that percentage is close to 5%, the procedure is working well in that scenario. If the percentage is very different from 5%, then the procedure is working poorly. In this first situation, we are sampling from a normally distributed population. So the normality assumption is true. And the percentage of these tests that reject the null hypothesis is very close to 5%. Theoretically, they should be exactly equal to 5%. The differences from 5% that we observe here are just due to some sampling variability. But what happens when that normality assumption is violated? Here we're sampling from a uniform distribution, which is definitely not normal. And when we have a sample size of 5, we're going to be stating a significance level of 5%, but the true significance level is going to be closer to 6.6%. We're going to be rejecting the null hypothesis a little bit too often, and the reported p-value will tend to be too small. But we can see here that as the sample size increases, that problem starts to go away, and the percentage of rejections that we see in the simulation gets very close to 5%. But even for a sample size as small as 5, the proportion of times we reject the null hypothesis in the simulation is actually fairly close to the stated significance level of 5%. The uniform distribution is perfectly symmetric, and it doesn't result in extreme values. Skewness and outliers can cause the t-procedures to perform very poorly, but we don't see either of those in the uniform distribution. So even for smallish sample sizes, the T procedure tends to work quite well here. Let's look at a different violation of the normality assumption. Suppose we're sampling from an exponential distribution, which has some right skewness. We can expect the T procedures to perform worse in this scenario. And we do see that. For a sample size of 5, we're going to be stating a significance level of 5%, but in our simulation we actually rejected the null hypothesis 11.6% of the time. The true significance level would actually be quite a bit greater than the stated significance level of 5%. And the p-value that we report would tend to be too small. But here again, we see this effect start to go away as the sample size increases, and these percentages get closer and closer to 5%. But there's nothing magical about a number 20, 30, or 40. We can see that even for sample sizes of 100, it's still a little bit bigger than 5%, although it's getting to be quite close. Here we're sampling from the blue distribution, which is a distribution that looks very similar to the red curve of the normal distribution, only it has heavier tails. In this situation, when the sample size is 5, we're going to be stating a significance level of 5%, but in reality it's going to be closer to 3.3%. It looks like the true significance level is actually less than the stated significance level of 5%. We're not going to be rejecting the null hypothesis enough, and the reported p-value will tend to be too large. But here again, that effect starts to go away as the sample size increases and these observed percentages are getting closer to 5%. If we simply report the results of a t-test when the normality assumption is violated, we may very well be misleading ourselves or others. As with any statistical inference procedure, we should investigate the assumptions where possible. Here we should check the normality assumption with a normal quantile-quantile plot to see if the use of the t-test is reasonable in that setting. And on a different note, even if the sample size is large enough for the t-test to be reasonable, there may be better statistical methods available. For example, if we are drawing a large sample from an exponential distribution, then we would be better off using statistical methods based on the exponential distribution and not rely on the large sample properties of the t-test.